So I'm here with JJ Waller, the photographer, for this episode of The Vote, and we're going to be talking about your book, JJ Waller's Lockdown. And you've become quite famous, haven't you, with your photos? Because they've been in the government's adverts. So we've all seen the two very iconic
photos. Probably not known it was my picture, but
we're going to see them on the screen as well. It's two very iconic photographs that were chosen for one of the first government adverts, and I know you've been around the streets of Brighton, haven't you, photographing people. So why did
you... Well, when it said that we were being locked down, we weren't allowed to go out, I was just thinking, as a photographer, what can I do? You know, photographers need to record things to show to people, to show people, to reflect what's going on in society for now and for the future. So I very simply just had that one of those little light bulb moments where I thought I could photograph people safely through their windows. And I'm sure I wasn't the only photographer in England that had that idea. But the fact that it was a simple idea was actually quite good because people got it. So initially I put out a little press release on social media in Brighton Hove News, and they picked up and made a little story. And I got six people that got back to me quite quickly saying, yeah, we would like to be photographed as a family. It sort of rolled on after that. As I posted pictures on Facebook, people were getting in touch because they got the idea. And the idea was, you know, this is a very important event in our lives. And it's something that should be recorded. We'd like our family recorded so that we can show, you know, future generations of our family a little bit of what it was like for us. So although there was no real kind of ulterior motive like a book, I mean, that wasn't in my mind at all. It was just the need to feel that some serious documentation.
Yeah.
And it was trial and error as I went along. I didn't know how I was going to do it. I mean, one thing I've learned as a photographer with a little bit of experience is now that if you know why you're doing something, it's probably not quite as exciting because you've already got some preconceived finality about it. Better that you're exploring and you're on an adventure. And in reality, it's not even over yet because the story is continuing and it's frightening. But so the book just charts one aspect of... I would say there's a fantastic polarity of sort of experience, obviously, you know. But there were people who... There was one woman I photographed who said to me afterwards, like, that was nowhere near what I expected to happen when you came. I thought I would put some lipstick on and, you know, smile and you'd take a picture of me looking through the window or something and that would be it. But she said, I just, you know, 5 minutes before you came, I had a call saying that my father had been taken into hospital. So that was on my mind.
Yeah.
You know, I knew that he was on his own and I knew that I wouldn't be able to go and visit him. And I was like, just full of emotion. So, and she said, you've captured that perfectly. You know, that comes through. It's not actually in the book, that picture.
Yeah.
And then subsequently she's talked to me and said how pleased and grateful in a way that moment was recorded because now her father's, you know, died, you know, and she wasn't able to be with him.
Yeah.
And another person who I photographed told me that their father had died recently, and the last words that she was able to have, the last communication she could have with him, was on a Skype. Well, that's really heartbreaking stuff, you know.
Yeah.
And then I met people who are doing their best to cope with large families and being confined to their home. And, you know, just one of the kids seemed to be getting symptoms all the time. And she was worried about her older son who had underlying conditions and knew that if he caught it, it would be very serious. But at the same time, she was educating them, trying to run her business. I mean, you've got to respect to what people have done. So you know, it's easy now to, as things are supposedly relaxed, to go out and see people shopping and people out on the beach, and it's just sort of easy to forget the depth of emotion and experience and heartbreak that the pandemic has generated in people.
Yeah.
We need to keep reminding ourselves that, you know, it is serious stuff. I mean, I walked past a bus the other day just to have a look, you know, because as soon as the rules came in, and I think Brighton Hove have tried really hard, Brighton Hove buses and the other bus companies, nobody was wearing a mask inside there.
Yeah.
And it's really down to us, not down to the bus driver to get into conflict telling people. And nowadays, in a week's time, shopkeepers have got to tell people you've got to wear a mask. You know, it's really difficult. It's pretty much the onus should be on people.
Yeah.
The number of times that I've heard on news broadcasts people saying, oh, the government weren't very clear about this, I'm not quite sure what we're doing. You know, I think the government were at some times saying, hey, work it out for yourself, you know, we're in this, you know, and be sensible. These yeah. are, you know, most things have been written down. A bit late, some of them, but...
A lot of people seem to be having fun in these pictures. How did you edit them? Because I know you've had some...
Well, two points on that. Yeah, Martin Parr was the editor.
Yeah.
Now, a lot of people will not know who Martin Parr is, but probably as a British photographer of our generation, or of our decade, or the last few decades, he's probably the world's most famous British photographer. So to get him on board was... well, I noticed that he was watching my pictures as I posted them on Instagram. So I knew that he was kind of following the project. And when the lockdown was coming to an end and I was beginning to feel there was more movement, I sent him an email, which is the great thing about social media, is that really you can try and communicate with anybody you want to, you know, in a positive way, hopefully. So I sent Martin Parra an email saying, I know that you've been looking at the stuff. In your opinion, what direction do you think I should take this work? What should I do with the imagery that I've got? Because by this stage, I've been to nearly 100 families. That's, you know, fantastically. I couldn't believe it, but when I totted it all up, I've been to like 100 different locations, safely, behind glass.
Yeah.
Obviously. And Martin Parr got straight back to me and said, well, surely it's a book. And then I thought, well, I'm going to be a bit cheeky here, but I wrote to him and I said, I'll kick myself if I don't have the courage to ask you, but I'm going to ask you, is there any way that you would feel that you could be involved? And he said, I would happily help with the editing. So I sent him an edit and he sent back his selection and I thought it was brilliant. So I didn't feel that I needed to change any of it at all.
Yeah.
So then I thought, well, hang on, he has edited it. You know, and he was happy and to.
Does
it's great.
Does it tell a story? Because how?
No, it doesn't really.
Right. Okay.
No, but the elements that might be worth pointing out. There was three locations where I did most of the work. There's Brighton Hove and round and about.
Yeah.
Then there was the village of Firle, which is a smaller country, obviously. And then there was Hastings and St. Leonard's, which is a place that I have a long association with as a photographer. So.
So what you left some photos out then? You've already mentioned.
Oh, hundreds.
How do you select?
Well, unfortunately, I didn't have to.
Right.
He did. Yeah. Martin Parr did.
And I wonder, were the ones that would you do?
I didn't have to go down that route.
Yeah.
So I would have been so subjective, it would have been very hard because I think I might have put pictures in there because the story and the interaction with the people in the making of that picture was quite memorable.
Yeah.
And I might have been sort of like seduced into putting that picture in when in actual fact there are other pictures that tell the story better.
Yeah.
So having somebody with a really good eye who's used to... I mean, Martin Parr's got over 100 books of his own.
Yeah.
So he knows how to sequence and to select images that tell a story, don't need to keep on repeating the same thing.
Yeah.
He did say that he didn't like the more frivolous ones and more sort of comical ones, but he did put in a few.
Yeah. Just re break for the first half. A lot of people are taking photographs during lockdown. I found myself taking photographs because, particularly when, you know, we were with our nieces through the window. You know, I think a lot of people have probably got a moment where they're kind of seeing their other members through the window, socially distancing. So we've all felt a need to kind of take pictures, normally on an iPhone, isn't it, nowadays? But
yeah.
We've all felt a need to document the lockdown, as you say, because we aren't going to be... It's going to live with us forever.
Yeah. What's your question?
The question is that we're going to see people are getting back into Vogue with images, aren't they, and taking images and looking, you know, seeing the world through pictures.
More and more.
Yeah.
I mean, even before
but particularly with the lockdown, it's people will look back on it through pictures, won't they?
Yeah. Well, I think that's the marker of history now.
Yeah.
Is the imagery.
Yeah.
And the power of imagery.
Yeah.
And the power of broadcast.
Yeah.
The power for good and the power for evil.
Exactly.
Time for a break.
Yeah. All right. We'll join JJ Wadder again in the second half to look more at his book, JJ Wadder's Lockdown. So I'm back here with JJ Wadder, the photographer. We're talking about JJ Wadder's lockdown, and we're going to select some of the most iconic photos, or the photos that you remember most, your favourite in a way. So I know it's going to be a difficult process. I'll give you the book so you can take a look through, and then maybe we can talk about, you know, some of those.
Well, first of all, is the cover picture.
Yeah.
It's quite important in the sense that. It was in the first day of shooting. So this is one of the first people that got back to me, Sadie, her name is, and her mum, I didn't know them, invited me to go and photograph them. And I made this picture of Sadie while her mum was... I asked her mum, I said, if you've got a laptop, we could perhaps, you know, you could be, you know, doing your home office sort of stuff, we'll do that through the picture. Because remember, I hadn't got a formula, I hadn't done any of these pictures, so I didn't know how much to direct them or whatever. The interesting point about going to 100 different places was you're not there for very long, but you have to react quite quickly. You have to compute how you're going to make the best picture in the fact that the light is very glary, or it's very dark, or a cramped space, or you're struggling to think of an idea that's interesting and original. And Sadie was looking through the window there, exactly as she is, as her mum was going up to get the laptop, and I took this picture. And when I showed the pictures both to the family, because I sent pictures to everybody I photographed, when I looked at this on the screen and showed it to a few other people, there was something about her gaze that was, you know, sort of compelling, something that somehow... In fact, it obviously has some impact, because this is one of the images that they used in the first government public information film, Stay at Home.
Yeah.
You know, and this was, I think, the second picture that came up.
Yeah.
It also, I think, I'm not sure if it had been in The Guardian. So that became quite an important. It's been used quite a number of times already in different campaigns.
Yeah.
It's in the book.
Yeah.
Just think of...
There's one at the top, there seems to be at the top of a kind of a castle. Build.
Okay, that was over in the village at Firth.
Oh, I thought it was, yeah.
And that was where the... Well, somebody lives there.
Yeah.
Somebody special in the village.
It's easy to social distance on top of that building.
Absolutely, yeah. It was easy to communicate as well. I was looking for the picture of the man through the letterbox.
Yeah.
There was one couple who I was photographing whose father was 96 years old, Billy.
Yeah.
And he couldn't come to the window, partly because he was... Couldn't get there, but I said, go and take a picture of him on your iPhone and put it through the letterbox. So I took a picture of, you know, I've got my picture of somebody who was kind of in the other room but couldn't come to the door.
Yeah.
And it's quite an interesting picture, I thought, you know. But it's difficult to pick out any. I suppose the other thing to say about the picture of Sadie... And one of the reasons why it got the response that it did was because it was shot through the frosted glass.
Yeah.
And I think they've got... this is something that I've repeated a number of times, because it seemed to have a stronger metaphor than some of the more direct pictures. It poses as many questions as it answers about the identity. Yeah,
exactly.
And about the how you're removed by, you know, the virus or something that's unseen.
Yeah.
And so it kind of like, it's not for me to say how people respond to something, but definitely those pictures have an impact.
And how we saw people through Zoom. I know there was a comment in there about people, you know, the young girl, I think, talking about how she saw her friends through the Zoom. They looked like squares. And yeah. I guess that's how we have seen people through, like a screen, in a way, a piece of art.
Yeah, it's one step removed. I mean, yeah, there's a really good introduction to the book that I recommend to read that talks about sort of psychological state. But the other thing about the book is you'll notice there's lots of quotes in the book from people that I photographed. And that in itself adds a really important dimension. Yeah. I mean, normally you would have thought in a photography book you don't need to have explanations of pictures. They should speak for themselves. But in this context, I think it enriches the book because it shows the diversity of feeling and emotion and experience. And it's become quite a vital part of the book and what makes the book stand out as just a more important record than just the pictures.
Yeah, and it's important to record lockdown. We've spoken about that before. Are you going to be recording the kind of the recovery of the city as well? And how would you go about doing that?
That's a good question. I did go onto the pier, for example, after I'd finished this project. Yeah. And I photographed the pier when it was... They kindly let me go on there and photograph. It was amazing. A lot of people in Brighton would be quite envious of the experience of just having the pier to yourself.
Yeah, it is great, isn't it?
A couple of hours. I know you weren't there. I mean, it's great. You know, with it, relaxed, just walking and just the fact
beautiful.
That... And I was looking back, it was on a very hot Saturday, and it was the first Saturday that everybody came out onto the beach, and it was baking, and it was like all the social distancing had sort of collapsed.
Yeah.
And there I was on the pier on my own, you know, photographing it, and it was bizarre, and... quite amazing. I don't know the answer completely how I'm going to photograph it. It's like what I started off by saying. If you knew what you were going to do, it might not be as exciting as what discovering slowly, letting it reveal itself, what might interest you.
Yeah. We lost our freedoms, didn't we, during the lockdown? Do you cherish your freedom to be able to go out freely and photograph...
I felt very privileged.
Yeah,
I must admit, because everybody was locked down and experiencing the sort of stuff that we've talked about, and I was able, probably one of the few people, other than media, film crews, etc., who were out on the streets, who were able to go and talk to people. I photographed some people up in Hangleton, and they said, "You're the first meaningful face-to-face conversation that we've had in 8 weeks with anybody, you know," and you have to sort of remind yourself that
exactly
that sort of thing has its toll, probably.
Yes.
As well,
we need to. What we all learn, I think, maybe, is that we do need that human. We need human touch. We need to be able to interact with people and most people on a regular basis, don't we? We need to meet people, and it's not quite the same Zoom, is it? Or doing stuff on social media isn't quite the same as meeting people in the flesh.
Yeah, and going out to people. I mean, I know I wasn't necessarily with them for more than probably 20 minutes max, but usually less, 10 minutes or so. I could see, and people said to me that it's kind of been quite good fun, they say. It's been a welcome break, you know, because it's something to do. And I did get the impression, once the word had got round, that people were inviting me just for have their portraits taken and have a bit, you know, meet this crazy photographer.
Yeah.
And,
how do we get the book then? And where is it available?
It's just, you know, online's good.
Yeah.
And Waterstones.
Waterstones, yeah.
And City Books.
City Books in Brighton as well.
Yeah.
And they did just type in JJ Waller's lockdown. It's going
to
come
up. You don't even have to do that. I think it's just JJ Waller. I'll get you there.
Yeah.
If you write latest TV,
you might
find me easy as well.
Yeah. So we're going to look at some more photos, JJ, as part of the book. I know there's one with people getting food via a bucket. Tell me a bit about that. Was it done in St. Leonard's or Hastings?
Yeah, it was, actually. It was done in St. Leonard's. Sounds funny, people getting food by a bucket.
Yeah.
But they actually did. They were isolating. They lived over a shop.
Yeah.
And they weren't going out at all. So the only way that they could get their food was they lowered down a bucket on a rope, and people filled the bucket and they hauled it back up. And that's how they got their deliveries.
Yeah, I guess that's one way of going about it, isn't it? So, if it works for them, that's fine. And it's interesting, though, is that people are finding different ways of,
using buckets.
Using buckets and self-isolating, yeah.
Yeah.
For a lot of people, that was, they really did seal themselves off, didn't they? I know we've spoken about this before.
Yeah.
But they literally, I know a lot of people that just didn't go out, or some people still aren't going out.
I met some friends who, in Brighton on Saturday, who said this was the first time that they'd been out, and they were finding it very strange. And I said, you chose a really bad day, because it's the busiest day I've seen in North Lanes.
Yeah.
People coming back slowly. Having said that, though, just people being busy out on the street, it is quieter, though. A lot quieter.
Yes.
I think it's going to be hard for people to have the confidence again, for a lot of people to be in public, to be out, going into shops, walking the streets. I think people have got so used to contrary to that, like, I live up at the Seven Towers, and I must say the shopkeepers up there were fantastic. The locals were all fantastic. It was a nice self-contained sort of community. It was very, very relaxed.
All right, JJ, thanks for joining us today. Thanks. All the best for the future. Cheers. Thanks a lot.
Appreciate it.